If you got your message notes out, you can pull those out. There's message notes on the app on our phone, which is easy for you to carry with you and to look around. You can get your Bible out. We're going to be all over the Bible this morning. So if you want to get your Bible out, you can do Bible drill with us and flip around. Today's core value is generosity. And I don't believe we're ever more like God than when we give, because God is a giver. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. God is a giver, and I think that as followers of him and being like Christ, we should be givers as well. I was at a ball game one time with my oldest daughter, and we made a run to the concession stand, and I got her a pack of Skittles, the bite-sized candy. And we went back, and we were sitting down there, and we were watching the game. And, Dad, you know how it is. I was watching her eating those Skittles, and I just needed a few of them. Just kind of hit me. I just wanted a little few of the Skittles. And so I looked at her, and I said, Addison, can I have a few of your Skittles? And my daughter, she was young at the time, she said, these are my Skittles. I said, but Daddy really wants some. Would you please just give me a few? I'm not going to eat them all. I just want a few. She said, no, they are mine. And at that moment, I had three thoughts. The first thought that I had is, my daughter has forgotten who the provider of Skittles is. That I am the great provider of Skittles. That if it wasn't for me, there would be no Skittles. And she's forgotten that. The second thing she didn't realize is I'm bigger and I'm stronger than her. And if I had wanted her Skittles, I could have taken them from her. The third thing that she didn't realize is that, and I didn't realize, is I didn't really need her Skittles. Because I could have walked to the concession stand and gotten my own. In fact, I could have probably bought every pack of Skittles that they had there. But that wasn't the point. The point was, I wanted to teach my daughter generosity. I wanted to teach my daughter to share. It wasn't that I really wanted the Skittles. I wanted her to learn how to share her Skittles. And as I was preparing this message today, this week, I thought to myself, there's some of us sitting in church this morning that have forgotten where the Skittles come from. That everything that we have in life, God has given us. And that if it wasn't for God, we wouldn't have one single thing. And God is bigger and God is stronger than all of us. And if he wanted to take everything that we have, he could take everything that we had, and he would be just and right in doing that because he's God. And the third thing is that God doesn't need our stuff. God could create anything that he wanted to have, but God wants us to have hearts of generosity because he knows when we give, we are more like him than any other time. I heard one person say this, and I thought this was so good, that you make a living out of what you get, but you make a life out of what you give. Isn't that good? People don't forget what you give. And this morning, I got a lot more preach in me than I do teach, and so I may lose my track of thought. I've just been, if you just woke up and you just had a vibrancy, just an energy in you that the Lord's given you, I just feel that this morning. I'm going to try to teach what the Lord wants me to teach, but it says in Scripture, just three scriptures real quick as we start. God says in Philippians 4:15, we become. Let me read off my. You became my partners in giving. We partner with God when we give. Because God's a giver and we're a giver, we're partnering with him. Hebrews 13:16 says, keep doing good and sharing your resources. That's what generosity is. 1 Timothy 6:18 says, be generous and willing to share. So here's what I want to do with the time that I have with you. I want to share with you seven benefits of generosity. Seven benefits of generosity. Before I step into that, let me just say one thing. When I say generosity, most of you are thinking about money, right? And obviously that's part of it. Money, being generous with money. And I've got some examples in here that we're going to talk about money some. But generosity is not necessarily just money. Generosity is everything. Generosity is your time. Generosity is your skills. Generosity is your the stuff that you have. Come on, somebody blessed me this week, took me fishing. Come on, somebody. That's a blessing. That's being generous. That's sharing. And that's good. That's good. Everybody with me this morning. Let's go. 7 points. This is a 7-pointer. The first one, generosity, 7 benefits of generosity. Number one, generosity creates community. When we give, listen, we become a part of something. If you've ever bought a stock and invested in a stock, what happens? You become interested and a part of that company. When we give, we become part of something. Look at what Scripture says in 2 Corinthians 9, 11, and 12. Yes, you will be, I love this word, enriched in every way so that you can always be generous. It says, and when we take your gifts to those in need of them, they will thank God. So two things will result from the ministry of giving. The needs of the believers in Jerusalem will be met, and they will joyfully express thanks to God. I love that scripture because it says, you will be enriched so that you can bless other people. Do you know all the stuff that God has given you is not just for you to absorb? It's not just for you. You are blessed in order to be a blessing. Look at what it says. I will enrich you so that you can be generous. And when you do that, two things happen from what Scripture says. Number one, you'll meet the need, the physical need of the people that are in need. But the second thing that will happen is they'll give glory to God. Two things. Generosity creates community. And when you begin to serve, when you begin to pray, you become a part of that. You become a part of that. When you contribute, you can be with a group but not part of the group because you become part of the group when you contribute. And our church is a generous church. We are known in our community, in the cities that we're in, as a church that will help other people. And that brings me such joy, and it should bring you such joy. We have phone calls every week that you don't get to hear, but people will call in and they will tell us, hey, we're struggling. We need some help. We're down on our luck, and someone told us to call the Springs because y'all help people. Can I tell you something? That's what a church should be. Now when we begin to be involved in people's lives, we are a part of the community. I'll never forget, about 8 years ago, we got a call. We started building ramps. For a time. I mean, we just built like all kinds of ramps for people to get in their house. It was just like a thing that happened. And we just started doing that. Some of y'all remember that. And about 8 years ago, there was an older gentleman who was in a wheelchair who was not doing real well. And they called us and said, hey, would you build a ramp at this man's house? And so a group of about 7 non-carpenters went out there and we built a ramp. For this, they were literally having to pick this elderly gentleman up and carry him down the steps and put him in the car. And so we spent the whole afternoon, it must have been July because I remember it was like 1,000 degrees. And we dug the holes, we built the ramp, and the joy on those people's faces when they got that ramp was just out of this world. And you know, that was 8 years ago. And I can see one of them today. And you know what they say to us? Thank you for building that ramp. He's gone to be with the Lord now, but they've never forgotten that. And everybody that comes, y'all need to go to the Springs. Y'all need to go to the Springs. You know why? Because we became a part of their community when we gave. We are a part of an association called ARC, Association of Related Churches. It's a church planting organization. They've planted over 600 churches since the beginning, about 10 years ago. 600 churches. Today, they're planting a church, I believe, in San Diego, California. And do you know, we have a part of planting that church in San Diego, California this morning because we contribute to them. We are a part. We're a part of that family because we're giving to them. We have a church that we're going to in July, on July the 12th, called Amor Viviente Iglesia. It's in Morsely, Honduras. It's our sister church. We love what they're doing there. We love how they're loving people. And do you know that we are a part of a church in Honduras because we're generous to them? When we come there, it is like a family reunion. Isn't that cool? Because we are a part of them. I love, Pastor Brian talked about VBS. VBS is great. And I love that a bunch of kids were up here shucking and jiving and all that stuff for Jesus and getting amped. And we've been singing those songs all week and they've learned about Christ. I love all that. But you know what I love most about VBS? Is that I see people who were not connected, who were a part of our church, but they weren't part of our church. But they served this week and now they're part of our church. They're in our church. They know people. They are a part of the community. I love that more than anything. Because when you serve and when you're generous, you become part of the community. Amen, Brother West. Number two out of seven. Generosity defeats materialism. Would you agree that this world is pretty materialistic? There's a mindset of I need more and more and more. I think it's a sickness that I'm going to get all I can, I'm going to can all I get, and I'm going to sit on the can so nobody else can get it. I want more, more, more. And the only antidote to break materialism is generosity. The only antidote. It's the medicine to materialism. Look at what Scripture says. No one can serve two masters. For you will hate one, or you'll love the other. You will be devoted to one, and you'll despise the other. You cannot, let me repeat that, you can not serve God and be enslaved to money. It's very clear in Scripture that everyone in this room is serving one of two masters. You are either serving God or you are either serving money. Because God's word says we cannot serve both. In fact, to illustrate my point, we'll just talk about two guys. We'll call them Bill and Ted because that's the era that I'm from. And first, we'll talk about Bill. Bill's a good guy and he attends church. And Bill wants to get from point A to point B, okay? And he's done the numbers. He's done the math. He's not stupid. He knows what his income is. He knows what it's going to take to get his house paid off. He knows what it's going to take to get his car paid off. He knows what it's going to take to pay for the kids' college. He knows what it's going to take to have some retirement when he gets ready to retire. So he's done the numbers, and he tells God, God, I understand what the preacher's saying this morning, but I've done the math, and the hard numbers is it's going to take 100% of everything that I make to get from A to B. That's Bill. The second guy, Ted, he's over here. Ted has also done the math, and Ted also wants to get from point A to point B. But Ted's going to take a step of faith. Ted's going to believe what God's word says, and he says that I'm going to trust God, and I'm going to live on 90%, and I'm going to trust God with the 10%. And so, I know I've got to be from point A to point B, and I want to get my house paid off, and I want to pay my car off, and I want to have some retirement, and I want to pay for my kids' college, but I'm going to trust God that 90% is better with God than 100% without God, and I'm going to trust the Lord, and I'm going to tithe. And God says to Ted, okay, I'm going to take you from point A to point B, but I'm going to take you to another whole level, Ted. I'm going to take you over here to C. Because when we're trusting God, there's a blessing on our life. There's a favor on our life that someone that isn't being generous or giving never experiences. Now, let me tell you this. Bill thinks Ted is an idiot. Because can you believe he's believing what this preacher's saying about generosity and tithing? You're sitting here this morning, you're thinking, there's no way I can give anything because it takes 100% of everything that I make in order to get to get to where I need to be. And Ted over there is crazy for believing what all this stuff says. Go right over here to Ted. Ted thinks Bill is an idiot because he's not trusting in the Lord with his finances, and he knows that he's never going to get there, and so he's an idiot. My question is, which idiot are you? Are you Bill or are you Ted? Because the scriptures clearly say we're one or the other. You're either serving God or you're serving money. Which one is it? When we give, it breaks that materialistic mindset in us, and we can live in C. Now, I'm telling you, C is a good place to be. C is the favor of God. C is the blessings of God. C is the protection of God. I got to move on. Number three. I'm really beginning to feel the preach come on. Number three, generosity strengthens my faith. Generosity strengthens my faith. When we give, we trust the Lord more. Look at what it says in 2 Corinthians 9:6. Remember this. A farmer who plants a few seeds will get a small crop, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. Don't expect anything to grow in the garden if there's no seeds in the ground. If we're going to be a truly generous person, we have to trust God in faith and be obedient. And I said about the tithe a while ago, you know, the tithe really isn't being generous. The tithe is being obedient. Amen. It's just doing anything above the tithe is generosity, but the tithe is just being obedient. That's the minimum requirement that God has said, return to the storehouse, which is the church in Malachi, so that you can be obedient. God doesn't need your 10%. God just wants you to share your Skittles. That's all. He doesn't need your Skittles. He just wants you to share because it's his stuff. It's his stuff anyway, and we have to trust the Lord. I'll move on from this, but in over 20 years of ministry, I've been doing this thing for over 20 years. I have never heard anybody say, y'all, that I've trusted the Lord and I've given, and that's the reason I'm in the position that I'm in. Never. This is what I always hear. The Lord led me to be generous, and when I became generous, I never could imagine how God had blessed me. Ever. That's every time. My quietness Presbyterian church this morning. Oh. All right. Number four. I'll continue on. Generosity is an investment for eternity. It's an investment for eternity. We are taking stuff on earth and we're making a difference in heaven. It says in Matthew chapter 6, verse 20, store up your treasures in heaven, where moths and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. There's never been a U-Haul behind a hearse. There's never been any pockets in funeral suits to keep money in because it's no good up there. It's just no good. You're investing. We're investing in something greater. And I don't believe there's a greater investment than in the kingdom of God. I don't believe you'll ever regret investing in what the Lord's called you to do. It's amazing to me that I can take something just physical, like a phone, or like a car, or like a home, and I can invest in people and make a difference for eternity. That's amazing to me. That I can shoot a text to somebody to encourage them, and I can use a physical thing to make a spiritual difference. It's incredible to me. Your car can haul like 7 people. You could bring 7 people to church. Those people get saved. It's incredible that you've made a difference with your physical thing. You could host a life group at your home, bring people in, people grow closer to God, get in community. You make a difference in eternity. Isn't that the neatest thing? When I work with my dad, I've always worked with my dad. He's worked construction. And he wasn't a dad that would let you sleep in the summer. He'd get you up. And I've worked with him since I've been about 9, 10 years old. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You had that daddy? And you're going to work, son. And I love to work. I love to work. And I was working in this house, and my job as a young boy was to go and pick up all of the extra scrap in the house and clean it up, and then I would sweep. So I kept the job site clean. And one day, a man that was working on the job came up to me, and he said, "Son, you're a really hard worker," and he gave me a $50 bill, a $50 bill. Now, my dad paid me in cash, and that week I had made $200, and a lot of times what I would do is I'd get it like in fives. Come on. So it'd be like a big wad, like sticking out of your pocket, you know? So I had like $200 in $5 bills, and I had this I had $250, and I had spent the $50 when the man gave it to me. I already knew. I was going to Electronics Boutique. I was going to get a video game that I already knew what I was going to get, and I already had it spent. I went to church that Sunday, and the offering plate come by, and I put four $5 bills in the plate. I give my tithe. I'm good. After church, I'm going to Electronics Boutique, going to buy me a video game. That's it. Then they had a missionary speaker that morning. You remember that he stood up, I think it was from Nicaragua. He was serving God and feeding kids in Nicaragua. He's feeding kids in Nicaragua. And he got up there and he shared about what God was doing, and you could give $5 and you could feed a kid for a week for $5. You could feed a kid $5. And the Lord began to speak to my heart. And he said, "You got a $50 bill in your pocket." And he said, "You could feed 10 kids for a week." I thought, have you ever bargained with God? I said, my game costs 30. I could feed four kids for a week and still get my video game. You ever done that? And God said, no. I want you to give $50 to this man so he can feed 10 kids for a week. $50. The pastor said, "We're going to take a second offering." It's bad when you ever been in church when the pastor said, "We're going to take a second offering," because the first one wasn't good enough. Come on, I've been there. The pastor looked at the bucket, he said, "Send it around again." Come on. We may need to try that. I don't know. But not just joking. But anyway, that bucket was coming, and it you could see it way down there on the end of the pew, and there wasn't like three people on the pew. And it was coming to me, and I could feel it getting closer. And that $50 bill was like going down in my pocket. It was crawling down in my pocket. And I got the bucket, and it was just a moment that I just kind of held the bucket. I had to make that decision. And I just took the $50 bill out, and I put it in the bucket, and it was like I heard it leaving. I didn't get my video game, I went back to work the next week, and the man said, "Hey, you spend your $50 yet?" And I just really didn't say anything. I said, "Not yet." Somehow, listen, my dad told him what I had done with it. My dad seen it. Let's just say I could have bought several video games after that, because he saw what a young man would do, what had done with that. It was such a, I didn't know that. I didn't even expect that. I was just being obedient to the Lord. And that's the way the Lord works. It strengthens our faith, and it's an investment in eternity. Let me hit these last three. Number five is generosity blesses me in return. It blesses me in return. It's stated over and over in the Bible. God blesses those who are generous. God gives generously, the Bible says in Deuteronomy 15:10, "Give generously to the poor, not grudgingly, for the Lord your God will bless you in everything that you do." He will bless you in everything that you do. Everything. That's that C area that I was talking about. God may not send you a check in the mail. Listen, but I believe that when you are generous, your tires on your vehicle last longer. That the roof on your house doesn't leak. I believe that your clothes endure longer. When you've got the favor of God on you, you just check your bank account and I thought it was lower than that. That's the only way I can explain it. That's C. Amen? I see some of you shaking your head. You've been there and you know. Number six. Generosity produces happiness. Generosity produces happiness. It says in Acts chapter 20, verse 35, "And I've been a constant example of how you can help those in need by working hard. You should remember by working hard." Look at what it says. "You should remember the words of the Lord. It is more blessed to give than to receive." Now, you've probably heard that before. But it's hard to believe that, isn't it? When you were a kid at Christmas time, you didn't believe that. It's not more blessed to give than to receive. It's better to receive than to give. Come on. Are you hearing me? No way. But you mature, and now it's more blessed to see your kids get something. That's maturity. That's maturity. I thought this was interesting. Generosity produces happiness. A study has been done. Generosity is one of the essential components, listen to this, of mental health. We found that generous people are rarely mentally ill. Isn't that interesting? I'm in a cycle of my life. I'm not watching news. I go through cycles. I'll watch news and then I won't. So I'm in that cycle. But I turned it on, and the first thing I saw on the news this week is Anthony Bourdain had taken his own life. And if you don't know Anthony Bourdain, he was a food guy that traveled the food. He was on the Food Network or whatever, and he took his own life. Now listen to me. If you don't know him or if you do know him, the dude's job was this: travel the world and eat. Can it get any better than that? And he took his own life. And I looked at my wife, and I said to her, "If that doesn't prove that the things of this world will not satisfy the soul, I don't know what will. It won't bring you happiness." The last thing is, generosity makes me more like God. Generosity makes me more like God. From his abundance, we all received one gracious blessing after another. Makes us more like God. So, let me finish up. It's 9:30. Come on up, musician. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, "You must each decide in your heart how much to give. And don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully." Listen to this real quick, okay? I want to teach you something. How do we practice generosity? Right here in this scripture. Number one, give thoughtfully. Give thoughtfully. God is asking you in Scripture to make up your mind. Make a decision on what you're going to give. To plan it. To plan what you can give. To make a plan to that. Anything that's important, you plan. Number two, give enthusiastically. Not like my $50 bill. Here you go. I'm going to give it. Give enthusiastically. Give voluntarily. Not under pressure, it says. Not under pressure. And if you feel pressured this morning that I'm talking about money and it makes you uncomfortable, don't worry about it. If you don't trust us as a church and you think I'm trying to manipulate you to get you to give money to somebody else. Hear me real clearly. Don't give it. If you don't trust our church, don't give it to us. Give it somewhere else. But don't feel like I'm pressuring anybody this morning. I've been pressured before. We're not going to make it if you don't give. Well, you just won't make it. And then the last thing is give cheerfully. In fact, that word means hilarious. Hilarious. I got like 3 hours of sermon in there, and I just put it in 30 minutes. So I'm feeling led to extend our service times right now. I'm feeling led. Hour and a half, 2 hour services. I think we need them. How am I going to end this message? I guess I'll end it this way. The thing that amazes me about God is that he would choose to involve us. That's what amazes me about God. It's not the fact that he's after our stuff. It's just the fact that he would allow us to be a part of what he's going to do. And I couldn't help but think about when he was in Matthew 21, when he told his disciples to go get the donkey and bring him, Jesus said, bring me the donkey, and I'm going to ride in on the donkey. And I thought it was interesting to me that he borrowed somebody else's donkey, because if I remember right in Genesis, he just told the animals to go get on the boat, and all of them walked together and get on the boat. Why didn't he just say, donkey, untie yourself, come to me, and I'll ride you in? Or why didn't he say, poof, I'm creating a donkey? No, he wanted somebody to lend him some of their stuff to be involved in the process of bringing them in, so that that person can say, that's my donkey the Messiah is riding. I raised it from a colt. His mama was that donkey over there, because he wants you to be involved in the process. Isn't that stinking amazing that God would want us to be a part and use our stuff and our car and our house and our stuff and our change and our dollars to make a difference in eternity? That just blows my mind that God would choose to do that. That God would say, hey, I could do this all on my own, but I think it'd be better if you're generous and we just do it together. And can I tell you, if you would be generous, not just in the church, but where you work at, with the people you're around, it changes everything.